going on with people in our church. Barbara had her hip replacement to get rid of her other hip replacement. And that was on Friday. She actually went home yesterday, which was kind of shocking to me, but she's doing well. So if you get a chance, you might just give her a call and tell her you're praying for her. But she's doing pretty well. She was told she can't tie her own shoes for 3 months. So I'm figuring she'll wait until next week, and not this week, but keep her in prayer. And then Joe had a bunch of teeth removed. Had dental surgery in Albuquerque, a lot of teeth removed, taps, and all those sort of things, and he's doing well. So we're thankful for that as well. Then remember Theron and Paula, they're traveling today back to Hobbs. They've been at a swim meet in Los Alamos. So that's where they're at, and headed back through all the snow, I'm sure, there in Los Alamos. Let's all stand together. If you haven't had a chance, you might go look at the kitchen. You can tell things are beginning to start changing. Won't be real long from now. We'll start getting our cabinets and all those things installed. So we're excited about that. Just keep that all in prayer. Pray that we don't find any issues behind sinks and counters and all those things. And if we do, we know God will help us take care of it. All right, let's pray. Lord, thank you that we can come and worship you this morning. Lord, I just pray that we would allow your spirit to move. And that, Lord, we wouldn't think about anything else except about you. Lord, we love you and thank you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Lord, you do so much for us. You never deserve it. But I pray that you would just take your word this morning, Lord, that it would touch our lives and not just sound good, but Lord, that we would apply it. Lord, that we would never forget our purpose. Lord, I just pray this morning that you would change us.
Government said we can't meet. But it happened, didn't it? I always said there'd never be a day to where the government could tell us how to worship. But they've tried. Now, notice I said try, because I don't listen very good. That's like Karen telling me to take out the trash. I don't hear that very well, and I don't like to be told what to do. Did you know that we were told we couldn't have congregational singing? Did we ever stop congregational singing? And it's, now it's on Facebook, but that's okay. No, why? That is part of our worship. Don't you tell me I can't sing praises to God, because I'm going to sing them, whether you like it or not.
Amen.
And so we see that all these things have happened. And as we study in 1 Corinthians, we realize we're reading about a church who just wasn't getting it right. They had all of this pagan, worldly influence that they were fighting. And they were having a hard time figuring out what was okay and what was not okay. So they wrote back to Paul. They had all of these questions. Are we allowed to do this? Are we allowed to eat meat that was served to, that was offered up to idols? Can we do this? Can we do that? And Paul begins to answer them. It is so interesting that the hills are here today. If you looked at us doctrinally, pretty much the same. Jesus Christ crucified, raised from the dead. Amen? If either one of us aren't about that, then you need to get rid of one of us or both of us. It's about Jesus Christ crucified, raised from the dead. But if you were in his service this morning, it would be quite so still. I've got to worship with him before, many, many times. Sometimes at different congregations, even a few times here at Bella. We may have different styles, we may have different types of music, but if it's focused on the one true God, then we're all getting it right. Amen? We're getting it right. Because it's not about if they sing with their hands like this. We see, you know, Karen does that. And I'll be honest, I don't know who else does it, because that's your business and you need to worship God. And the last thing you need me to do is miss every single note of the piano. But we worship. It may be different. His congregation, I'm sure, is different. But it's about who we serve. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning in verse 23, it says, I have the right to do anything, you say, but not everything is beneficial. I have the right to do anything, but not everything is constructive. No one should seek their own good, but the good of others. I want you to see this morning how to be free. I talked about it Wednesday night. I talked about it in Sunday school. Now I'm going to talk about it right here. Right now, Bel Air Baptist and your pastor is under a strong spiritual attack. And when I say Bel Air is under strong spiritual attack, I mean Bel Air, y'all. The enemy's going after the leaders. But he's going to go after you as well. When the enemy attacks, that's because we're doing something wrong.
Amen.
That's when we're doing something that God has called us to do, and we're getting it right. We should be happy to know that the enemy's attacking because there's some reason that he's attacking. And I got to tell you, I've said this for weeks, but I'm tired of Christians that act like we lost the battle, because we have not lost. We have victory through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. We have victory through Jesus Christ. Stop acting like you lost, because you have not lost. The battle is won. You go, well, it doesn't feel like it. Well, don't go off your feelings.
That's right.
You know, I felt real good. Karen made my mamaw's homemade chocolate pie from the secret recipe that my mom gave her. And I'll be honest, I thought, yeah, it won't be as good as mamaw's. It was good. It was so good that she didn't want me to eat all of it, and so she took one of them to work, which I haven't really got over yet, but she took that. But you know, after after I ate the pie and drank my coffee, in about 15 minutes, it was over. It was a great pie, but it lasted 15 minutes. Now I went on to eating candy and things that I like to do. Our victory in Christ was never meant to be temporary. It's not temporary, it's permanent.
Right.
We have to stop acting like we lose. The first thing I want you to see this morning is to be free. No, it's not about you. It's not about you. This passage is really, really, really clear this morning. There's a lot of things that you can do, and it's not sinful. That's what Paul's talking about. He's not talking about being sinful. He said there's a lot of things you can do that are not sinful. But is it constructive? Does it build up the body of Christ? Does it build up people and lift Jesus Christ up to the lost? It should be constructive. There are things that I do. It's not bad. But is it constructive? And he's saying it's not about you. It's about other people. No one should seek their own good, but the good of who? Of others. Brother Oliver, it's not going to be surprised if I cry a little bit. It happens to me. It happened in a long time. You know, my friend that I work with, whose daughter was murdered in front of his grandchildren. I see him and talk to him a lot. You know, he uses words that I don't use. He says things that I don't say. But when he comes in my office to work and he sits down and he starts talking to me, you know what? I don't care which words he uses. My friend needs Jesus. My friend is hurting so bad that he doesn't know what to do. He doesn't need me sitting there going, don't say a cuss word like that. You can't say that. But what he needs is someone to listen and to love him and to be there and know that he can depend on him. You know, when I was sick the week before for 2 days, and I never get sick to the point I don't work at the house, I didn't work at the house. He called me. And people are like, that's not how he operates. Well, that's how he operates with me. Why? Because we're friends. And he knows that I love him and I care for him and I want to help him as he hurts. And I want to help his family. And I want to help those little grandchildren that he's raising now. Hopefully my boss isn't listening right now. But I'm about 5 months behind on bills to enter for my job. You know why? Because I've done a lot of counseling. And the truth is, my boss, Mr. Strickland, knows that, and he encourages that because he knows life isn't about just me crunching the electric bill. Life is about people's lives and other people and how they're affected by what we do. In verse 25, it says, eat anything sold in the meat market without raising questions of conscience. For the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. If an unbeliever invites you to a meal and you want to go, eat whatever is put before you without raising questions of conscience. But if someone says to you, this has been offered in sacrifice, then do not eat it, both for the sake of the one who told you and for the sake of conscience. I am referring to the other person's conscience. Not yours. For why is my freedom being judged by another's conscience? If I take part in the meal with thankfulness, why am I denounced because of something I thank God for? The second thing to be free is know your limits. Now my dad was pretty strict. And I would try to convince my dad that going to particular parties in high school would be okay because I wouldn't do the bad things they were doing And then, you know, I let him see what a good Christian high school boy looked like. My dad, are you stupid? I mean, are you that stupid? Do you think you're going to go and be the only one to get it right? He said, why put yourself in that situation that is unnecessary? Because if you put yourself in that situation, you might have found out that you'll do the same thing they're doing. And now your Christian witness has been absolutely destroyed. Because the next time someone says you should be going out underage and drinking and acting crazy because I'm a Christian, someone go, oh, you're a Christian. You act just like I do. What's the difference? You know, I told you the story many times. My friend in college, there's 12 guys, and 11 of us went to church every Sunday. I was leading worship at a little bitty church in Albuquerque and working with youth, and we were all involved, and we partied every single night. We would go to church Sunday and act like we were different. And we had one friend who was not saved, and he said, y'all are stupid. I'm staying home, and I'm going to sleep because y'all are no different than me. So whatever this Jesus thing is, it must not be very big because you do the same things I do. And that friend died that year in a motorcycle accident. And my friend's going to spend eternal punishment in hell because 11 other knuckleheads could get it right. Every day, I remember that. Every day, I go, Lord, I don't want my witness to be that kind of witness ever again. Know your limits. I know pastors who have ministries at bars, and they have phenomenal ministries. They can handle it. That's good. Amen. They know how to work in that ministry. But know your limits. It's saying if you go to someone's house that's not saved, and they serve you something that you normally wouldn't eat, eat it anyhow. It's okay. But he said, if they say that this was used in sacrifice to a god, little g god, then don't eat it. Because if you eat of that food and knowing what it was used for, then you're saying it's okay. How many times have you done something like, it's just a little thing. God's okay with that. He's cool. If it was such a little thing that didn't matter, why did you bring it up? I mean, if you brought it up, oh, God will be okay with that. It's just a little sin. You know it's sin, right? Sin is sin. When Jesus died on the cross, which ones did he die for? All of them. If he didn't die for all of them, we're in trouble. Because if he died for most of them, I'm sure that I'm probably sinning in the ones that are not okay. He died for every sin. And he's saying, be careful in the situation in which you put yourself. Now, I give these young people a hard time. And they're just like my own kids. I mean, really, they're just like my own kids. And I'm always telling them, be careful in the situations that you put yourself in. You think you can handle it, but you may not be able to. You have to be careful. Probably shouldn't tell this, but I'm going to anyhow. This attack began a few weeks ago, and my flesh kicked in for a moment. I wanted to punch somebody. I'm not just saying that to sound tough. I wanted to punch somebody. I was so mad, I wasn't thinking. But all of a sudden, I saw someone else standing nearby. And I went, what if I do this stupid thing and punch this person? It could have been ruined, destroyed my ministry. All because I got mad. And I did something that's really, really, really hard for Sean Drake to do. I turned and I walked away. And I've been praying for that person every single day, often. And I asked God, hey, God, forgive me because you knew my heart. You knew what I wanted to do, and I'm sorry, Lord, because I don't want to destroy my witness. I don't know who was watching that needs Jesus. I don't know that. Know your limits. If you're a little bit hot-headed, maybe you need to turn and walk away. Anything you say in anger is not going to go well. Well, it's not going to go well. It's going to come back, and it's going to get you. I'm telling you, it's going to get you. Brother Oliver won't know this story, but he'll know it. And from now on, he'll never forget it. Well, my parents were pretty young in their marriage. Dad had a little bit of a bad habit. He passed it on to me, unfortunately. But he doesn't have much of a temper, but when it kicks in real. And Dad was in Vietnam, and he had bought these special things, these China things, for Mom. They were special. Well, they had an argument. Dad took an old football helmet and he threw, and you know what happened? He broke it. The candy dish. I don't even think I was alive then. And if I was, I was barely alive. I was two. So obviously, I don't remember it, and my brother was not alive. He had not been born. And every time my brother and I get in trouble, we figured out this really cool thing. We figured out that if we could get Mom onto the candy dish story, that we were off the hook. And she would remind him, yeah, remember that candy dish? Because he threw you a little temper tantrum and he broke the candy dish. We weren't old enough to know it, but I know that story like the back of my hand. In fact, my brother and I, on our 50th wedding anniversary, found that candy dish. Took my brother a lot of luck to let him look. Why do I bring that up? Because it's a joke in our family now, but it wasn't a joke for a while. Don't act in anger. Remember who you serve. The victory is not yours. The victory is God's. Don't forget. In verse 31 it says, so whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. The third thing I want you to see is to be free. Know to do everything for God's glory. The girls, oftentimes when we're practicing on Wednesday and I get choked up and teary-eyed, they'll come over here and get a tissue and bring it to me. In fact, they about break their legs being the first one to give me a tissue. They give me a hard time about it. And one night, we were singing a song that Brother Jim Laster sang. And I sang this song at my grandfather's funeral. And every time I hear this song, I cry. And so I begin to tell them why I cried over this song. And it hit a chord the same way it hit me. And we couldn't even finish the song because we were both just bawling. And Jared's just like, all right, guys, come on, man, come on. And we're just crying. Why? Because she started thinking about how that song touched her. I watched her every week grow and grow and grow. And she's learning that what she does, the talent given to her by God, and she's using that talent as a 13-year-old kid, using that talent to worship God. Oliver knows all about using kids for worship because y'all been doing that too, just like us. We train them up, they go away. We train some more up, they go away. We keep training them up. The service a while back, when I knew that she's beginning to sing, it's not about her, it's about God. As I saw her, she did what I call a Baptist hand raise. You know, one of these. And then just really slow, it's Baptist, although she's not. I can teach her how to sing all day long. But when she does it for God, it's His glory and His honor. Everything you do should be about God's glory. I don't know if y'all know this, but at Bel Air on at 1:30 or 1, I can't remember. I think it's 1:30 Chicano time, as you would say, Brother Ray. At 1:30 Chicano time, we have a church that meets here. They're not Baptists, by the way. If you don't believe it, just come to our service. And people say, you let people know, ain't Baptists go to your church? Now, this ain't you. This is other Baptists. I said, why wouldn't I? That's crazy. Well, you know, they get kind of carried away in their music. Well, they don't. They're worshiping God. Some of those same people, when they hear that you're going to have a service here, they're going to say the same thing. Well, they ain't Baptists. Well, praise God. Are they children of the King? Are they child of God? That's what I care about. Are they going to preach the word? Jesus Christ crucified, raised from the dead? That's what I'm wanting to happen. Why would I not let other congregations come here and use our building that God has so richly blessed us with to lift Him up so that people will be saved? And Brother Oliver, I will tell you that people get saved. You need a baptistry. Now, Brother David will fill it up for you. He's better at it than you. We have a hot water heater, so it ain't even cold water. That wasn't nice.
And it's not about us.
Verse 36, do not cause anyone to stumble, whether it's you, Greek, or the church of God. Even as I try to please everyone in every way, for I am not seeking my own good, but the good of many, so that they may be saved. The last thing, be free, no, it's about people being saved. When he says Jews, Greeks, or the Church of God, he's talking about everybody. That covers it, okay? Many translations where it says Greek, it says Gentile. It covers everyone. Don't cause people to stumble. It's really difficult to not get your way. Right? Let's be honest. There's got a little girl with cerebral palsy that went to this championship meet. She's not real fast. And she took last place, but took off 41 seconds in 100, which you may or may not know that, but it's not very far. That's a lot of time. And apparently at this meet in Los Alamos, if you win your heat, you get a rubber ducky. I took swimming a long time ago, never seen that, but they give a rubber ducky. And all of his athletes, with this little girl, had a rubber ducky. And she swam really, really, really well. She didn't win. But one of the meet officials went and got a rubber ducky and said, young lady, I see your time, and I see how fast and how much you improved, you get a rubber duck. And Theron said, Dad, it was like she gave him a ducky that was made out of pure gold. She was so excited, that she was jumping up and down, and I told Sunday school this morning, this is the same kid who no one would let play on their t-ball or their soccer or their basketball team because of her cerebral palsy. She couldn't play in those sports. And her mom took her to the swimming pool one night, and Theron and Paul was having a swim team meeting, and Theron, with his great hearing, could hear that the little girl had a limp or something, and so he let Paula take care of the meeting, and he followed over, and he said to the mom, hey, does your daughter have cerebral palsy? And she said, how would a blind guy know that? And he said, well, I swim in disability swimming. I've won medals at Rio. I've run won gold medals in world championships, so I know about disabilities. So he told the little girl, get in the water, swim down there to the wall, swim back, don't hold on to anything. And he said, she made it. And he said, hey, young lady, would you like to be on my swim team? Darren said, the mama starts bawling. She's just bawling. And the little girl's screaming, I get to be on a team. Darren said, I always carry my goggles around. I'm like, why? You're not swimming. He said, because the day that they were kicking and holding her kickboards, she shouts out, I'm on the best team ever. And look at all of my new friends. Darren said, goggles on, because I didn't want them to see me crying, because they had some 12-year-old boys that would never forget. And ever since then, that little girl does whatever he asked. Her parents, they do anything Darren needs. They do it. You go, how is that relevant? It's because that's how it is as Christians. When someone gets saved, they have the greatest victory that they could ever have on this earth. Their life changes. And they're in a family now. They're the body of Christ. They're no longer out there where no one seems to want them. Because the world don't want you unless you got lots of money or power or prestige or something like that. The world doesn't care. But Jesus cares about the lowest person on the planet. Because when he died on the cross, he died for all of us. For God so loved the world. It wasn't for God so loved Baptist or Methodist or whatever name you want to throw out there. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. That whoever believes in him, right? Whoever. We're a whoever. Believes in him. My ministry, of the Hills ministry, any other ministry is about anything other than Jesus saves, and Jesus strengthens us and grows us and matures us. If it's about anything else, we need to quit. If it's about me, how good looking I am, and I know I'm pretty good looking, if it's about that, and that only I need to quit. And if it's about how good looking Brother Hill is, we got the same awesome hairstyle. Ain't got it. If his ministry is not about people being saved and people being assured in the faith, then he needs to get out. Refreshing Fire Ministry, just in the title, tells me that something's happening, right? Tells me that something's happened. But even a cool name of a church means nothing if we're not lifting up Jesus. Y'all know I hate Walmart. Y'all know it. And God bless me with a wife that doesn't hate Walmart. I had to go to Walmart the other day. She didn't even know because I didn't want her to rub it in. I had one thing I needed to get. And there was these bad little kids running through the store. I mean, they were knocking things off the shelf like Tyler Grape used to do. And that poor mama, she was trying to wrangle these bad little kids, and she was trying to figure out what to do. And that one little kid came over and actually punched me in the leg. Crazy. I picked him up, and I'm holding on to him. He's pretty squirmy, but I can handle that. And I'm holding on to him. I said, you know what? I'm bigger than you either. You need to calm down. You should be nice and you just can't. Well, that always works. That's a grandparent of me. And so all of a sudden, the mom comes over. She's already had to chase one around the other aisle. She comes over and she said, praise God for you. I said, hey, I used to have little children. She said, are you in a hurry? And the truth was, I was in a big hurry. I said, why, do you need some help? She said, yeah, my husband always comes with me shopping. got injured at work, can't walk. Where don't you know I'm busy? I already carried my own kids at Walmart when they were acting bad. And so I carry two children. I think I got the most active two children. And I helped her while she shopped. She didn't know the layout of the store very well, which meant we did a lot of hiking and walking. Paula's prayer for me has been answered that I exercise a lot, because this week I have. When she got done, she rang up. I helped her get the kids in the car and all that. And remember, I didn't even buy what I wanted to buy. I didn't buy it. I just went, I don't get it. The lady told me, I will never forgive you. Because people don't just help. And I said, I help people because people have helped me. And God knows just when we need help. And so I'm very happy to be able to help you. And your kids ain't that bad. They're just kids. I'll never know if she figures out who I am or that I pastor or what I do. I'll never know because I didn't tell her that. I just showed her kindness and love when she needed help. God will put every one of us in situations to help and to lift him up. Don't just walk away. It always happens at the worst time. You know, I always said as a pastor, people never get sick or people never die at 2 in the afternoon. It's always like 3 a.m. when I'm sleeping. It's not about what fits your schedule. It's about who you serve. I tell people all the time how giving and loving Miller is. Don't take my compliment and then just stop. Keep serving. I read a survey this week that once I got done reading it, I cried. They got the Gen Z and the Generation X and all these things, and I don't know that much about it. But it runs into my kids' generation. And the statistics show that only about 25% of that generation believes that the Bible's true and that Jesus died for their sins. Only about 25%. And I thought, how could that happen? Here's how it happened. We changed church to entertain people. We changed church to say, oh, don't worry about giving your tithes and offerings. It doesn't matter. I may not preach sermons about money, but part of being faithful is to give of your tithes and offerings. We've told them, don't get involved. We'll hire people to do it. Don't ask things of children that adults normally do. Don't do that. Just make them feel good, make them happy, and do things that'll bring them back. That's not what God called us to do. If I don't say something every once in a while that doesn't hurt your feelings in a sermon, then either you're not listening or I'm not following God.
Amen.
And y'all come out of church today probably like you do and you say, well, God really spoke to me about this, and I'm going to go, hey, you don't preach about that. What are they talking about? Because God knows what you need this morning. He knows exactly what you need right where you're at today. That's the God we serve. That's the God that changes people's lives. You're tired of all of the politics and the craziness going on in this world? The cure is easy. The cure is Jesus. Every revival that's ever happened happened during a time when it looked like the world was done. And one person or two people stepped up and just started telling the truth of the word. And I'll tell you, youth, pay attention, because the revivals, all except one, started with young people. They didn't start with us old guys. They started with young people. Can you imagine if our young people in the city of Hobbs start following Christ and everything they do? Could you imagine? That would get all of us fired up, get us moving again. It's about people being saved. I'm tired of people walking around like they have their certificate of salvation in their wallet. And then, hey, I'm going to heaven. I got my ticket to heaven. What about those people who do not? I want you to stand with me this morning. I'm going to do something different. So don't play the song. I'm going to just hope my friend will forgive me. Brother Oliver, would you mind just going to the piano and play something? See if the Lord leads you. This is why I always tell the pastors, I always tell them, you better carry a song in a sermon. You're going to have time and invitation. You're welcome to come to the altar and pray. You can come pray with me. But whatever the Lord has laid on your heart, whoever the Lord has put on your heart, this is your opportunity.